Good morning. Welcome to Bazaar Morning Call. I'm Lata and with me is just Sonia. In fact, we have a lot of absentees today. It was easy drive actually. Everybody wanting the Friday off so that they could get a 4-day off. Perhaps the only deterrent has been the surging plane fares. Yes. Otherwise, we would have had more absentees.
A day before a holiday, after a holiday. So I guess that's just everyone's just in holiday mood, right?
Absolutely. One could see it in the roads as well. But, I think there's nothing stopping the bulls. I mean, there may be holidays, fewer working days, but it's almost an unstoppable position. And I want to refer to the Fed minutes and the other data that came out of the Fed meeting as well. The Fed says no rate hikes in 2019. That's a confirmation of something everyone expected. But what was new and which actually needs maximum importance now is that the Fed's contraction of its balance sheet ends in September this year. Now, this is important. What it means is, you know, the Fed had bought a lot of paper, mortgage-backed securities, U.S. treasuries, so that a lot of liquidity is pushed, much like our OMO, but on a more permanent basis, it had bought them. Now, every time they matured, the Fed used to buy them again to keep the balance sheet expanded. Now it says that once it is redeemed, it will take the money back and contract its balance sheet. So it was contracting its balance sheet for the past 2 years. Now it says the contraction program is over, which means further liquidity tightening will not be there. Mm-hmm. That's a very big positive for emerging markets and for, well, risk assets in general. But now since emerging markets are in the ascent, it's a bigger advantage for the emerging markets. So the Fed stopping the contraction, which means it was tightening liquidity, it will stop tightening liquidity. It's a very big positive. And we will see the impact. Actually, people were smelling it and that's why we saw the liquidity flow. But now there could be a little more of liquidity flow into emerging market assets like India. And we can already see that 1770 crores on Wednesday, yes. Taking the total tally in March to over 25,000 crores. We are going to see more of that. Let me just leave with one minor negative. Crude has gone over $68, now probably $67.97. But that, if it continues to strengthen, is a bit of a negative for India.
Yes, I agree totally. That's the only niggling worry, right? Otherwise, everything seems to be in fine fettle this morning. Also what's been happening in the month of March, the Nifty is up 7%, but the Bank Nifty is the one that has really surged. So it's up almost 11.5%. And the PSU Bank Index this week has outperformed the index itself. So yes, I take your point about the numbers. FI is buying about 1,700 odd crores, almost 25,000 crores in March. They've increased their exposure in index futures as well. So, you know, that's an important angle to look at. The Dow is also up overnight, so almost 200 points of gains on the Dow. The Apple stock surged as well. But this week, what's happened is the Nifty is up about 0.8%. The PSU Bank Index is up almost about 3-odd%. And led by heavyweights this week. So if you look at, you know, Reliance, SBI, HDFC Bank have all done well this week and this month. That's the performance of SBI, Reliance and HDFC Bank this month. Double-digit returns. So I guess these are the stocks that will continue to be in focus.
Oh, absolutely. These are all FII favorites.
Yes.
So you're going to see that. And then there is the other variety that's going up, which is totally value beaten down stocks like, you know, PSU banks. Mm-hmm. So there are a bunch of reasons why stocks will be bought. One, because they're FII favorites, even if they're expensive, you continue to buy them. And there is the other lot which have been beaten down so much that people are looking for value over there. So actually, the long and the short of it seems to be that people are looking for a reason to buy.
Yes.
And therefore, a whole variety of stocks up. But some opinion coming from Chris Wood?
Yes. In fact, the level to watch, in case you're watching on the Nifty, will continue to be that record high of 11,760. So that's the level that everyone has their eye out on now. But let's tell you what our wise experts have to say as we head into trade this morning. It is Friday. So Chris Wood of CLSA says there has been $3.3 billion of net buying of Indian equities by foreign investors since an opinion poll was released on the 4th of March, showing a big increase in support for the BJP following the airstrikes on 26th Feb in Balakot in Pakistan. He says greed and fear has always thought BJP would win the forthcoming general elections, but there is no doubt that concerns had been growing in recent months. Chris says if the risk in India from a fund flow perspective remains that inflows into local equity mutual funds slow further, at least such flows remain positive. He adds there's also definitely room for foreigners to increase weightings as they have not added to their holdings in Indian equities for 3 years. He says as regards the latest Indian economic data, the most encouraging has been a pickup in fixed capital formation, but still the forthcoming general elections will be held in the absence of clear-cut evidence of an economic upturn.
I think that summarizes everything that's positive and negative. A stable government, but there isn't any evidence of economic growth, though the positive is that definitely there's a slight pickup in fixed capital formation. Well, with that, there's more opinion, actually. Since it's Friday, there seems to be more notes coming in. Sean Darby of Jefferies says there is a very big difference between a policy pause and rate cutting. Idiosyncratic risks remain a problem for financial markets. Reach for yield theme continues to dominate asset allocation decisions. It is the flow rather than the balance sheet that determines asset prices. They remain positive towards equities, but understand it is a mature economic cycle. It's a bit of a warning in terms of the economic cycle.
Okay, well, let's get you some money market views as well. From being the worst performing currency about 6 months ago, we've now become the best performing currency in the Asian gamut. 68.80 is where the dollar closed. Bhaskar Panda of HDFC Bank says the dollar INR has been more volatile than expected. It broke through the important technical level of 68.80 to 68.50 intraday, but rallied to close around 68.80 again in the last two trading days. Given this background, he expects the dollar INR to trade in a range between 68.60 to 68.90 today. He says a breach and closing below 68.50 will call for a further downward movement below the 68 mark.
Yeah, but it appears that the Reserve Bank has been active at that point, and there were also extraordinarily short positions on the dollar. So when we went to 68.40, we came down to 68.90 in a hurry. So perhaps the rupee strengthening, at least for the moment, will take a pause. And then you have crude today as a minor negative. So a rupee appreciation today may not be. But then if the flows come like they have been coming, then next week could be another story. Bond markets, Bhaskar Panda says, they've been remaining in a range and will stay that way. He expects a 10-year benchmark bond yield to trade within the range of 7.5% to 7.55% today.
Okay, well, let's talk about the world markets. The Dow had a decent rally yesterday, a 200-point up move. Mangalam is here to give us more details on that. Hi, Mangalam.
Hi there, absolutely. A big move coming by on the Dow Jones, a near 200-point rally on yesterday's trading session. And it was the Nasdaq which outperformed as well. Why did the Dow move higher? Because Apple, that heavyweight, moved about 3.7% after a brokerage upgraded that stock to a strong buy from just a buy on account of valuations. In fact, Apple's move negated the sort of financials which were dragging the index. And that's primarily on account of a couple of macro news. Why was that? Well, the Fed has opened its liquidity tap. They've said no rate hikes, explicitly mentioned no rate hikes in 2019. This versus December commentary of two rate hikes in 2019. More importantly, they will end the balance sheet reduction by September end. So that tells you post-September, there could be some more liquidity. And given the Treasury yields have been lowered, there could be the rush out of money from the US into the emerging markets. All of that has come at a cost of lowered economic growth outlook. So let's see how that pans about. A bit of uncertainty coming in on the US-China trade issue, with Donald Trump saying maybe tariffs from Washington on Beijing could stay for a substantial period. So that was something that caused a bit of a jitter in the previous trading session on the Dow. Across the Atlantic, though, it was Britain written all over. It was the FTSE, which was high by about 0.9% for a couple of reasons. The first one, Bank of England held their interest rate steady. Secondly, the EU has granted extension and till April 12th to the British government to go ahead and indicate a way forward for Brexit. So that is something that the street will be keeping an eye out on. For the Asian markets, they are more or less mixed now in the red as we speak. For SGX Nifty, it'll be important to see what happens. Crude is higher, but currency is stronger. So what's the offset? The SGX Nifty, while optically indicates a 9-point down, compare it to Wednesday's close on the Nifty futures, and that's a gain of almost 37-40 points at the start. So let's see where it sustains.